Good morning, church. Welcome to the service of worship today. I'm Jisun Yang, serving as an associate pastor here, and I'm so grateful for each of you to join us so we can worship together this morning. I know this is really challenging season to keep in touch with each other, so I'm so grateful for your presence today. Please do not hesitate to let us know you are here or your prayer by submitting online connect cards. Today, Pastor Chris will preach the power of simplicity as the second message of July series, Unexpected Gift Along the Way, Lessons Rediscovered During a Pandemic, to explore our own experience of simplicity as we go through this seasonal pandemic. Every spring, our church has a beautiful tradition for third graders as we celebrate their growth and bless their journey. This year, it happens a little different way. Last week, we had the Bible class online for them, and their own Bibles are on the way. And I encourage you to continue to support them and bless them as their mentors and teachers or friends as we walk this journey together with them. And if you have third graders in your home, entering fourth in the fall, please let us know. We love to share the Bible with them. And so before we move on, I want to say thank you for your serving, for your giving, and thank you for being a part of this community. Your presence, your service, and your contributions in many different ways are so important for us to share God's good news for all people in the world. And there are many continuous mission opportunities of sharing food items in the church breezeway or donating the handmade masks or ordering masks. Also, you can make monetary donations on the church app, website, or mailing a check. So let's center ourselves and fix our eyes on God as we begin our worship.
Hi, everyone. For our experiment this week, we're going to keep things simple. The only materials you'll need are an empty water bottle or container, some hydrogen peroxide, some yeast, water in a cup, some dish soap, some food coloring, and a tray. Simple things from around the house. So what are we doing first?
First, we pour in the hydrogen peroxide. I'm helping me to do this because I do not want to get that all over my hands.
So what's next?
Next, we pour in the dish soap or dish detergent. Boom.
Now what?
Now we add 10 drops of food coloring. 9, 10.
Good.
This is going to be a lot of fun. I hope it doesn't break.
Okay, now what?
Now we're going to put our mixture of yeast and coldish, hottish water into our mixture of hydrogen peroxide, dish soap.
So that was pretty cool, huh?
Of course there was for me.
But why did this happen? So what happened inside the container was a chemical reaction. The yeast in this experiment acted as a catalyst. A catalyst is any material that causes a reaction to begin. So here, the yeast breaks up the oxygen that was present in the hydrogen peroxide. Because this reaction happens quickly, a large amount of bubbles from the oxygen were released at once. Now, if we touch the container, and Molly, you touched it earlier and you observed this, you can tell that it's pretty warm, maybe even a little bit hot. That's because this is what's called an exothermic reaction, meaning that the product of the reaction is oxygen and heat. So today in our experiment, we kept it simple. We combined a few common household items, and look what happened. In this week's readings, someone approached Jesus asking how to be good enough to get into heaven. Jesus told him, get rid of everything that you do not absolutely need. Basically, keep it simple, and you will get amazing results, just like we did here. So this week, think about a time over the last few months when you did something simple, like spending more time hanging out with your parents or your siblings, and when that simple thing that you did led to something unexpectedly fun, like building a pillow fort or hearing a funny story for the first time. Take some time to talk to your family about all the times when doing something simple worked out and became something fun. Think about this, and we'll see you next week.
Good morning. Music can be healing, moving, and needed. Needed in times of joy and in times of sorrow and in times of unity. Sometimes all you need is a simple melody. And you're transported to a meaningful time in your life. So now let us join our hearts together in song and enjoy this simple gift of music.
This place.
One day, Jesus says, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can move the mountain. We might not be able to measure the size of our faith, but even small faith is what God seeks for us, because our prayer in faith has power. James chapter 5, verses 15 to 16 say, the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up. And anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. So let's pray for one another. Let's lift up our hopes and dreams before God. Maybe we do not have enough power, but our prayer of faith as a community has power to move mountains. So would you please join me in prayer? God of love and mercy, we praise your mighty name, the creator of heavens and earth, and the everlasting God from the beginning to the end. We praise Jesus' name, who made a new way for us. You made a simple and easy path for us and invite us just to believe in you. So we put our faith in you and follow you. You are the good shepherd to provide us everything we need to share and to love. And you are the author of life to breathe the new breath in our lung. You are the good father to call us. You are my beloved children. You are the one to be with us when we are forced to adjust to so many things in our lives. You are the source of life, so we give you thanks for our family to share laughter and tears. We give you thanks for our friends to pray for one another. We give you thanks for our community to help one another to grow. Lord, give us faith deeply rooted in your love, not based on what we have, what people say to us or about us, what is happening around us in our lives, but faith deeply rooted in your love. And help us grow deep and wide and see unexpected gifts along the way in this challenging season. This morning, we lift up our prayers for our families and friends. Have mercy on those who are fighting against this virus all around the world. Please provide them a proper care and bless the hands of doctors and nurses, first responders, and caregivers delivering your love through their hands. Have mercy on those who are in mourning and grieving from their unexpected loss. Our hearts are aching and breaking from our human loss, but give us new hope of eternal life and new energy to live into your calling day by day. Have mercy on those who are sick and hear our prayers for them. You said the prayer of faith will save the sick and you will raise them up. Please remember our families and friends who are suffering from various health conditions, waiting for surgery, in recovery, and maintaining their condition. In this time when we are almost giving up, We listened to your tender and soft voices calling us again and never given up on us. So help us be persistent in prayer and provide your wisdom to know your time. Help us experience your grace that does not require us to be perfect. Help us truly experience your grace to receive us as we are with no condition. Help us accept one another as we are accepted. Help us love each other as you love us, expecting nothing in return. We pray in Jesus' precious name and continue to pray with the word Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Today's first scripture reading is Matthew 9, verses 16 through 26. Then someone came to him and said, "Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life?" And he said to him, "Why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. If you wish to enter into life, keep the commandments." He said to him, "Which ones?" And Jesus said, "You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother also. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." The young man said to him, "I have kept all these. What do I still lack?" Jesus said to him, "If you wish to be perfect, go, sell your possessions, and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me."
When the young man heard this word, he went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Truly I tell you, it will be hard for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again I tell you, it will be easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." When the disciples heard this, they were greatly astounded and said, "Who then can be saved?" But Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals, it is impossible, but for God, all things are possible." The second reading is Psalm 16, verse 6. "The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage."
This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I don't know about you, but I like to keep things simple. Not too cluttered, not too complicated, but simple. Easy to use, easy to figure out. Doesn't matter whether it's a piece of technology, if it's the car that you would drive. I like things fairly simple. Simple and simplicity is an attractive concept and an attractive idea to keep things free of too much clutter and too many options. Yet, it doesn't take too long before the allure of simple wears out and gets a little old. And quite frankly, if things are too simple for too long, we get bored. We begin to get anxious and long for something a little more interesting or fast-paced. Well, for the month of July, during our sermon series, Pastor Jisun and I are looking at unexpected gifts, lessons rediscovered during a pandemic, and looking particularly at things that we may know at the head level, things that are important in our lives or that we long for, but we have been forced to grapple with or maybe even rediscover some of these concepts over the last few months in the midst of the coronavirus pandemic. And one of the things that so often I find in my life, in my normal and busied life that I long for and am always looking for is greater sense of simplicity. We long for a simpler time. Let's keep it simple. But yet I have to tell you, after 3 months of things being simple, I'm ready to get on with my life. Let's think about for the last few months. What has your life looked like that's been some sort of imposed simplicity, that things that otherwise we would do or that we would have the luxury of, and yet we have been forced to live with fewer options, less luxury, and in some ways, fewer distractions? Well, right away, I think about eating out. I have eaten out significantly less, actually only gone to restaurants just a couple times, and most recently outside. Eating out is something that would normally be a regular part of life, either with the family or with other people over meetings. Going to restaurants really hasn't even been much of an option. And I have to say that keeping that simple has saved quite a bit of money and also some calories. Also, I know a lot of people over the last few months, they've kept things simple, particularly some of the guys I know. They haven't shaved. Have you known anyone who's grown a quarantine beard? Or maybe they've let things go up here? Life has been a little more simple. One of the realities that I personally have loved when we attend meetings on Zoom, if you have used virtual technology to connect with other people, we may have to get dressed up top, but you never know if people are wearing their pajama bottoms or their shorts below, because we can keep it simple. And yet, here we are in the middle of July, and simple is wearing thin. We are longing for a busier, hastier pace of life. But during this sermon series, I'm speaking to myself as well as everyone else and want to say, not too fast. Let's not rush too quickly until we can take note in our head and our heart, and maybe even write down, what are the things that God has for us to learn that maybe we already knew, but we have been forced to rediscover? And today I want to talk about both the power and the importance of simplicity. In the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 19, we just heard this passage in which a young man comes to Jesus and he asks him a question. It's very similar to the question that the lawyer asked Jesus in the Gospel of Luke. They both say, Master or teacher, what must we do to inherit eternal life? And in the Gospel of Matthew, the young man who asks Jesus is not trying to trick him, is not trying to catch him in anything. He has a sincere desire to know. He says, what one thing must I do to have eternal life? And so Jesus says, you know the commandments. Follow God's commandments. In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus is first and foremost a rabbi, a teacher of the law. So he reinforces the covenant between God and God's people in that law. And he says, follow those laws and there you will live abundantly with God. And so the young man says, which ones? And Jesus grabs a few from what we call the Ten Commandments and he throws one in at the end, which is love your neighbor as yourself. But Jesus doesn't stop. He says, but if you want to be perfect, now, not the English concept of perfect. It's more a complete. If you want to have everything, if you want to be whole, Jesus says, go and sell everything you have. Give the proceeds to the poor. Well, this passage has been debated for centuries. Is Jesus discounting money, or what is called in Greek mammon, right? Currency, wealth, possessions? Is the only way forward to live in God's eternal life is to get rid of everything that we have? And so this passage is debated over and over again throughout the centuries through theologians as to what Jesus is saying. But it's important that we realize Jesus does not stop there. Jesus is actually saying, if you really want to be complete, follow me. Come, follow me. And in the middle of those two clauses is, if you want to be complete, sell everything you have, give it to the poor, you will have wealth with God, and then follow me. Jesus' point is not that he wants this man to have nothing, but Jesus, the point is that for this man to have fullness is to come and follow the way of Christ. It's one thing to believe in Jesus, but it's another thing to follow Jesus, to actually see what it's like, the rhythms of grace, and to experience what his life and love is like. It's one thing to have Jesus in the head. It is another thing to have Jesus in the heart. And here he's calling even a step further, which is to follow Jesus with our feet. And now for this man, because they call him a young ruler, and often this is referred to Jesus and the rich young ruler. Perhaps he was a noble of the people. Perhaps he had some inherited position and inherited wealth. That we know that if this man were to join Jesus' circle, Jesus had an inner circle of 12 students that he handpicked. Jesus had other concentric circles of people who followed him and traveled with him as well. There were women who supported the Jesus movement. There were other folks who journeyed with him from place to place. We don't know if Jesus was inviting this man to be one of the inner circle or one of the concentric circles around him. But can you imagine if this man would have entered this community in which they shared everything that they had together and their main focus was trying to keep up with the master who was showing them a completely different way of interacting with the world and with people and healing and freeing people from their own burdens internally and externally. Imagine if this man came in and constantly was surrounded with trappings of his position and of his wealth. If his assistants were following him around, begging him to make decisions and answers, and people were giving him things that no one else around him had. In this case, to follow Jesus, what this man had and what he prized so much, what he worked and his family probably built up over generations, would have come between him and the ability to be nimble and to see the simple blessings of being in the presence of God incarnate, the Master, Jesus, who shows us God's heart, who does unexpected things, who redeems people who are rough around the edges, who heals those who are sick inside and outside, and even who can free people from captivity and raise the dead. Here Jesus calls this young man to be freed of the things that distract him so that he is open to do the ultimate thing that makes us complete. Follow Jesus. Follow Jesus. Don't just believe. Don't just do, but follow. Now, this journey took Jesus' own disciples to lots of unexpected places. They fell down along the way, and Jesus picked them back up, both figuratively and literally. In the presence of Jesus, he made fractured groups of people, a whole community, and Jesus took those who were pushed on the sides of the margins and who were cast out by society, and Jesus valued their belovedness and claimed their status in God's reign as whole and important people. But sometimes, the things that have become so important to us can cloud our vision. And so in the last few months, whether we have been forced to slow down or to stay at home, spend more time with family, we haven't felt like we've had to shave, or whatever the imposed simplicity has been, there have been unexpected gifts and lessons along the way to remind us about what is important. For me personally, I've found that not having that hour early in the morning where I'm rushing around to get my children ready for school, since we're homeschooling, we have an extra hour in the morning. I've been using it in quiet and in silence, a time to let the busy voices settle like dust in a stream for clarity and in prayer. I'm eager, like many people, to get back to a busier pace of life. But when I do, I don't want to go back to a place where the desire to be successful, the desire to have the things that we want, the desire to have many options begins to prevent us from accepting the beautiful gifts that are around us and the people that God has given us in our own homes and our neighbors, but also the power of silence. This may seem silly, but one of the first indications that we were living in a simpler time was very early on in late March. I ordered something on Amazon Prime, and my wife and I are used to getting things the next day or 2 days later, no matter what we order, whether it's groceries or a piece of clothing. And I remember it took 2 weeks for it to come. And it reminded me of my childhood in finding something in a catalog and circling it and sending in a check and waiting. You see, the immediate gratification that we have come to rely on in so many ways has changed the way that we interact with the world. We want people to do what we want when we want them to do it. And so we lose a sense of patience and now being forced to go backward in time where delayed gratification is not only a reality, but I remember a moment in time when it was a value. When it could teach us about something, to work for something, work up to something, rather than press a button and then get angry if it takes 3 days for it to show up at your doorstep. Well, today packages are coming more quickly than they did 2 and 3 months ago, but I don't want to go back to a place where we take anything for granted, because the bottom line, particularly of this passage, but also of the Christian life, is not what we think and not just what we believe, but it is how we follow. Jesus calls every one of us, again, not to sign on a dotted line, but to constantly follow Jesus. And Jesus does not walk in a straight line. Jesus walks in a crisscross line. If you look at the map of all the treks that Jesus took from the northern region to Jerusalem and down south to the Dead Sea area, Jesus was constantly giving his disciples, no matter how young and in shape they were, a run for their money, in the same way Jesus says to us. Lay your burdens aside. The things that distract you from what's important, put them down and come and follow me, and I will show you the rhythms of God's grace. It means that we will mess up. It means that we will make bad judgment calls, but we must be nimble to take the hand of the one who will help us up. Jesus offered the same hand to the man in Matthew 19. Now the passage ends that the man was sad. He walked away. He knew that he couldn't follow Jesus, not because he didn't want to, but because what he had worked too hard to lose the things that were so precious to him and his family. We haven't had a choice to lay down the complexities of our lives, to step out of the busy schedules, to put some of our dreams and our comforts on the shelf for a moment. And I have to say, there has been power and beauty in that simplicity. I don't want to return to a time and a place, and I don't want for our church and our community and our country to return to a time and a place where our desperate need for what we want now keeps us from the bigger picture of what it requires for us to follow Jesus, to care for those who are hurting, to stand up for those who have been pushed on the sidelines, and to open our hearts to God's heart and what God can do. I want to invite you this week, just as in any week, if you have a journal or somewhere, whether it's on your smartphone or elsewhere, to take account for your own encounter with simplicity. Where has simplicity been unexpectedly beautiful for you in the last few months? And what are the things that you have learned that you don't want to forget as life becomes more complex, more complicated, and more fast-paced. And may we follow Jesus together, seeking to keep up and have God work through our lives. Amen.
Time with
its promise is fleeting. Of water and wine, I empty the cup and found myself wanting. But there is a well that never runs dry. The water of life, the blood of the vine, and all I know is everything I have. This world I counted as loss. I lay it all down to take up the cross, and all I know is everything I have means nothing. Jesus, if you're not my one, everything I need right now, and all I want is everything you are. And I'll sing, oh, 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 I want nothing but to know you and to be with you, my God. And I'll sing, oh, 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 and with everything within me, I will worship you, my God. And all I know is everything I have means nothing. Jesus, if you're not my one thing, everything I need right now, all I need is you.
Dear friends, if we truly want to be complete, to have our lives filled with God's eternal life and God's eternal love that bridges us from this life to the next, that propels us forward, let us lay the things down that hold us back. Let us run the race, and the race is in following Christ, in following Jesus, who shows us that in God's eyes, we are all beloved, we are all sacred, but we all also have to participate in the healing of the wounds of the world, repairing the breach, and seeking to show God's love in all places, in all ways. And when we fall down, Christ offers the hand, helps us up, redeems us, brushes us off, rounds out the ragged edges, and makes us whole. As Jesus said, with humans, salvation is impossible, but with God, nothing is impossible. So let us run the race together, and let us be the church in a hurting world. Amen.
Jesus, if you're not my